only show giving you constitutionality reality. It's Disassociation Nation with your host, Niz, coming to you live now.
Welcome to Disassociation Nation with your host, Niz, and his merry band of Nizians, Nick and Paul. Niz is, alas, still not with us, so Nick and Paul are filling in. Disassociation Nation is live on the Freedom Phalanx Network at FPRNradio.com. Today's date is October 23rd, 2015. If you'd like to call in and talk to us, the number is 218-895-3818, or you can Skype us at FPRN Radio Live. If you have something you'd like to share with the show, you can email his Nizness at Niz, that's N as in Niz, I-Z, at FPRNradio.com. We also want to add, after talking to Niz, our main man, that Disassociation Nation is now a BIPCOT.org licensed show. That means that this show may be used freely by anyone else who wants to use it, unless, of course, they represent the government or they are using it in service for the government. To find out more information about this license, go to BIPCOT.org and tell them Niz and the Nizians from Disassociation Nation sent you. Today, our A and B block is going to feature a fellow ANCAPper and also a fellow host on LPRN Radio, Shane Radliff, which is pronounced Smith, who hosts Liberty Under Attack, which airs Sunday nights. Is it 6 p.m. Central Time or 7 p.m.?
6 p.m. Central.
That's what I thought. I got it right. So we asked Shane to be on the show to talk to him about his blog series, which is featured in libertyunderattack.com. And the name of the series that we're going to talk about is Adventures in Illinois Higher Education. Hello, Nick, and hello, Shane. How's everybody doing tonight?
Good evening.
Yep, good evening. Doing well, doing well.
See, now, Shane answered the question, and Nick, you said good evening. Is that an answer to my question, or is that a theoretical proposition that you've put before me to figure out?
A little bit of both.
Arr, I love it. So
what would you say? Am I having a good evening, or am I just saying good evening?
I would say philosophically and theoretically that you are having an evening of a possibility which is wrapped up in a conundrum which could suggest the propositional reality that you are, in fact, not sure. Is that correct? Do we have that?
No, I'm just having a good evening. I'd like to mess with you.
Shane, do I get an A in your class for that?
I mean, as far as philosophy goes, I really don't know. We don't get anything that in depth.
Come on, I think that was pretty solid gobbledygook, man. Come on.
I mean, I could see. I mean, I could see that coming out of the mouth. I mean, at least the reasoning coming out of the mouth of a leftist. So yeah, I think you probably would get an A in the class. So
I think I nailed that. So here's a question I like to ask people, and I'm going to answer it myself, but I'm going to go last because you know I like to go last. What have you done this week to advance the cause of liberty? I'm going to start with Mr. Nick over there, since he gave me that philosophical Gordian knot.
Well, other than sharing a lot of the stories that I find on the internet, try to talk to people, maybe wake them up if they're open to doing so, but that's about all we really can do as people from the freedom movement.
Now, Shane, I know that you do stuff. So, what would you do? A lot of stuff every week,
because I try. Yeah.
So, what would be the most adventurous thing that you've done this week in the advancement of the cause of liberty? Besides, of course, being on the show, which probably is tops of the whole week.
Oh, of course.
Yeah, I mean, let's be honest.
I would say me and Kyle Reardon, if I'm going to be correct here, we released an article titled "Jumping the Minarchist Ship: Why and How America Came to Be," and it runs through. I put together a metaphor of like the sinking minarchist ship, and it's just a metaphor. And then in part two, he explains like the constitutional ratification period. We attempted to debunk minarchism, so I think it came out pretty well. That'd probably be the top thing, obviously, other than being on Disassociation Nation. So,
well, yeah, I mean, that's like Disassociation Nation, and then like every second is way right. I mean, let's be honest, way down,
Down the list.
Right. I mean, we're on Niz's show. This is Niz's show. So
I do want to ask a question before we get too far of Shane. Okay.
That's always the answer.
That's fine. Go ahead. Well, I was going to ask, have you ever visited Homan Square?
Homan Square?
Yes.
I try to avoid Chicago as much as possible. So no, I have not. I wrote about that story. I don't remember when it was. Probably earlier this year. But
it's
never been there. Don't want to go there. Don't feel like being.
And I don't feel
blame like
you.
Definitely detained.
I do not blame you. I was just curious if you've never ever been around the area, what your thoughts might have been about it.
Yeah, unfortunately, no thoughts. I know it's in Chicago, and I've seen a picture or two of it, but yeah, beyond that, nothing.
Right on. Anyway.
Wow. So this week in my advancement of liberty, I've done so many things this week, of course. I mean, that goes without saying. But I actually had a really good interaction with my daughter. My daughter is going to public school. It's maybe I'll unfold the story in the upcoming episodes, but I'm not exactly happy that she's in public school, but she's seeing things that are happening in public school that I've been warning her about. My daughter is only 10 years old, and for a 10-year-old, she's a little bit advanced in her thinking. Maybe it's because her dad always gives her a lot of long philosophical discourses, which probably a 10-year-old can't understand, but you know. But she is actually starting to see how the teacher is framing things. When they talk, for instance, about global warming, and they talk about global warming like it's settled science, I see Shane chomping at the. Are you just enjoying your mouth, or did you have a thorn in your side there?
Oh, the global warming thing. Yeah, that kind of that's definitely pushed in a higher level indoctrination too. So.
Yeah,
it's frustrating. Yeah,
but my daughter what I've been teaching her is I'm not going to teach you what to think because that's not my job. My job is to give you the critical skills because ultimately, whatever you think, you have to stand on your own and say, why do I think this? And so she's starting to apply critical thinking. So I'm like, from a parent's perspective, I'm like, okay, we're winning so far. So far, we're winning. But I'm watching closely. I'm watching very closely. She's in fifth grade and. I'm sure you know Shane in fifth grade. They really start to step it up. So there you go. That's my wonderful cause for liberty. I publish a newspaper. We released our newspaper this week, and we got some good examples of subtle examples of liberty in our news stories, the way that we cover our news stories. But Shane, I did not bring you on here to talk about my newspaper or my daughter. I brought you on here to talk about I've actually been following your adventures in Illinois higher education, which is really fascinating to be able to read this. I went to college, and I think I told you during the pre-show, I was a liberal when I went to college, so these were my people, so I didn't even notice things. But you are coming at it from a different perspective, and what's really fascinating is I'm anxious to see how this develops for you and where it goes over the coming couple of years or so and what you end up with at the end. But before I get to that, let me ask you just a couple quick questions here. First off, tell us a little bit about how you came to be a believer in true liberty in the Cliff Notes version, pretending that you're talking to my daughter.
Okay. Yeah, of course. Well, I started out, I guess, more in the conspiratorial realm and continue with the conspiratorial realm up until when I was a sovereign citizen for a few months. Tried to restore constitutional government, and then I decided to start Liberty Intertech Radio, and my co-host, Matt, he is a black flag anarchist. He doesn't adhere to any, I guess, specific school of thought, just the negation of all rulers. So I guess from interactions with him as well as probably Kyle Rudin from the Last Bastille blog as well, but it was a really easy decision to come to once I Once I went on my political field trips, my Adventures in Illinois, Adventures in Illinois Law series. So I was experiencing government and also some influence from some colleagues. So that's how I came to anarcho-capitalism or voluntarism.
And on an unrelated but related note, Nick, after last week's show, where are you at in your view of have you been nudged further away from the idea of a state, or are you further towards?
I've always pretty much believed in the idea of voluntarism anyway. You know, as far as a whole, we just kind of need to do away with the state as its title, and us, I know it's going to sound kind of crazy, but us become the state where we are the ones in charge like we should be.
Okay, so you're getting there. I'm going to put you down as getting there. And you're probably going to say, no, I have it right. I have it exactly right. You need to get there. So back to Mr. Shane. Tell us a little about your Sunday show, Liberty Under Attack. I try to listen when I can. Sometimes Sundays I am with my family. I can't go away from my family on a Sunday. No. but I do try to listen to the archives when I can. But I really do like what you guys are doing over there. But with what you're doing on Liberty Under Attack, what do you hope to leave your audience with consistently on a week-to-week basis?
Well, the most important thing is consistency. Within, I guess, I'd like to say small L libertarian, completely separate from the Libertarian Party, but consistency is key if we're going to be successful in restoring our liberty. The second thing is to actually provide solutions. I've listened to a lot of radio shows and things like that. And obviously informing people about voluntarism and anarchism and about the state is a really, really good thing. But I haven't seen a lot of pushing of solutions. So what we're definitely focused on now, for the past couple of months we've been doing interviews. We've interviewed folks like Stephanie Murphy, Mark Wood, who's the developer of MetaMarket. We've interviewed a lot of people in the past 2 months. But
you had Nick Hazelton on recently, right?
We did.
He's
cool guy.
He's awesome. Yeah,
Lou Fiend too. Just like you guys did last week. But we're kind of focusing more now on solutions. My co-host, came out with the Freedom Umbrella of Direct Action, which is the utilization of the economic means rather than the political ones like voting or running for public office or writing your congressman or protesting or things like that. So we're trying to push a lot more of the solutions out there and give our listeners options on how they can create more freedom in their life.
Yeah, and I'm totally with you on that. And I mean, like you, I believe that we need a little bit of everything. And we do need the proclaiming. And I certainly want to do my share to do that too. But what I really love is I love solutions. And by solutions, I don't just mean, although I do mean this also, I don't just mean what can we do in our personal lives. Like, I haven't gotten to it yet, but I am definitely going to do the unregister your vote.
Canceling voter registration?
Awesome. Right. Yes, I'll definitely be doing that. But also, and I've heard this a little on your show too, where you are actually preparing people to be good apologists, to be able to defend liberty. And if you can defend liberty, then you can witness liberty to folks in a more consistent way, winning the hearts and minds. Because ultimately, if we're ever going to see a place where we actually do have a voluntarist communities, it's going to come from the heart. It's going to come from the will, from people saying, you know what, this state stuff, it's been 3,500 plus years, kind of going around in circles, aren't we? You know?
Yep, that is true. And it's time to break the cycle.
It's time to leave your abusive husband. And, you know, don't,
that's a good way to put
you know, baby, I love you. I'm not going to beat you this time. Come on, man. Take me back. Come on. You know it. You need me, baby. You need me. Okay, I'll go out and vote again.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, definitely. Definitely. It's
So now I'm going to transition here to your adventures in Illinois higher education. First of all, I read a little bit, so I know a little bit about why you're going to college, but just for our audience, why is it exactly that an ANCAPper is going to a government college?
It's a good question. I'm glad you asked. Well, I'm definitely not going to learn. That's pretty obvious. The reason is my dad's starting up a distillery. He's got all of his freedom licenses and permits and such. So it's
freedom licenses.
So he's going to start up a distillery, and one of the requirements or stipulations is I have to have my college education, and I don't have to pay for it. So it's pretty much I'm going to write articles. That's the only reason I'm going, but he wants me to get that magic piece of paper. I'm not necessarily sure if it's, I think he's smart enough to know that I'm not going to learn anything, but I think it's more so just to make sure I'm committed and devoted, I guess.
Where is he at? Where's his worldview at politically?
That's another good question. I don't know how to label it. There's some, I guess, neocon tendencies. He was a Republican his entire life. There's some neocon tendencies. I've talked to him about voluntarism, and he thinks it's a good idea, but he just doesn't see how that's possible. Just as I can't see, and Hitchens' razor. I don't have to prove that voluntarism would work. They have to prove that limited government will work, and empirical evidence shows that it doesn't. But his place is kind of, you know, I think it's a good idea, but I don't think it's possible. He's still kind of stuck in the
I like what you said. If I could rephrase it, mm-hmm. You know, I'm kind of with you when it comes to voluntarism. I walk out being consistent with liberty, and this is where I end up. So I think to myself, you know, this is the right proclaiming to make. This is the right liberty proclamation that we should be making. And I don't know how we're going to get there. But I do know one thing. I do know that government, that limited government, definitely doesn't work. It's not even a question. There's no doubt about it. It's kind of like, you know, I've had 15 friends, and they all got cancer. And one after another, 14 of them died. And now my 15, they died taking, you know, drug A. And then drug B comes along, and I don't know if drug B is going to work. Man, you can't do that. You don't know if drug B is going to work. You got to give them drug A. That's the way we've always done it. But see, I know that drug A is not going to work.
Right? That's a good way to put it.
Yeah, they're going to die. You know, there's no question about it. So you answered a little bit of this, but I'll ask the question anyway, because maybe you want to go into a little bit more detail here.
Mm-hmm.
What do you hope to achieve by going to college, other than getting that sheepskin? And you talked a little bit about the articles, but have you thought a little bit beyond producing articles and getting that little piece of paper that says you know how to do something that you could demonstrate by actually doing?
Yeah, I could always go do a trade, but I'm one semester away from my associates. That'd be a lot of wasted time. I guess the reason I'm going now is I always knew that colleges were more left leaning. I knew there was some leftism in there, but what I didn't realize before, I guess probably back in May when I wrote the first article in the series, I didn't know how explicit and how overt it is. I mean, it's the open praising. My sociology teacher openly praised communism and Karl Marx. Like, this isn't just some like overt thing, like subconsciously getting into the heads. This is like right out in the open.
Referred as an economist. I read that in your
yes, yeah, yes.
That must have been awesome. Right?
It was hilarious. Yes, it was. Yeah. It was a good joke. She didn't take it as a joke, but I took it as a joke.
Did you laugh in her face?
No, I'm trying to. I don't wear any. I have two Liberty Under Attack shirts, but I do not wear those in class. I'm trying to do more of the gray man thing, kind of be, I guess, kind of be covert and
the gray man,
not let them know where I stand.
Actually, that leads to another question I have. Do you have a standard within you to balance out the need to get a good grade, because your dad wants you to have that degree, you got to have a passing grade, with the wish to reflect to the other people truth in the class? Because I imagine you're a proclaimer, you're a truth teller, so it must be hard to sit in the class. Do you have like a core standard that, you know, I know how to follow this. I got my boundaries.
Yeah, I guess there have been a couple times where I've only in the study of the most dangerous superstition, as Larkin would put it, in my American government and politics class. There have been a couple times where I've kind of spoken up, but when it comes to sociology and philosophy, there's really not. I really just don't, because I need to get a good grade so I can pass. So I can actually get that magic piece of paper. But yeah, in American government politics, there are a couple times, and I probably sound like a constitutionalist, but that's pretty radical inside the walls of a college. But yeah, I've challenged my teacher on the 14th Amendment a few times. And also the Obergefell versus Hodges decision, the one that legalized gay marriage. We kind of went toe-to-toe with that for a little bit. But I kind of know what I can say without, I guess, exposing.
So you don't have a, would you say, would it be accurate to say that you don't have a clearly defined boundary, but you would kind of go by feel? You go by how the teacher's reacting?
Yeah, there's kind of a limit for me, I've seen, except for sociology. In sociology now, sometime, maybe when I have a guaranteed grade, maybe I'll challenge the teacher and kind of debunk communism using Austrian economics. But as far as with that, it's just there's way too much to combat in sociology. But when it comes to American government, like, I've challenged the teacher a couple times, like I said, and there's never really been a concedence. All he really says to my answer is, he's like, well, that's one interpretation of the Constitution, and then he says his little ditty about, well, rational, logical people disagree, and that's what politics is for, to determine the values of society. So, like, that's his comeback to, like, everything that I say, and it's like, you know, I really can't debate this guy if that's all he's going to respond with. But that's all he knows how to respond with. He doesn't know how to actually rebuke what I'm saying.
Considering what I've heard from others, that's actually a pretty nice response compared to what you may have gotten from other teachers. So,
yeah.
Hey, kudos to you for being vague. You know, vagueness is better than totally invalidating. The reason I ask you these questions, because I'm hoping that other folks will follow your example, and you have a lot to teach folks from your experiences. You know, you, especially if you need to get that grade or that whatever, that sheepskin at the end, got to know your boundaries.
Mm-hmm.
But at the same hand, what is it like to sit in a class and to hear somebody spewing half-truths, lies, and innuendos in which they're raising up an army of people who will one day be your enemy?
I would say they're my enemy now. They advocate for violence. They would advocate for me to be tossed in a cage if I didn't pay my taxes. They're already my enemy. And yeah, it is. I wouldn't say scary now, but when I look at these people when they enter the workforce and they go into the voting booths and things like that, yeah, it's pretty terrifying. It's definitely pretty terrifying. But pretty much, I try to come at it with, it's the only way I can really survive. I come at it with like a comical. I'm watching a comedy movie or something, because it is truly, truly hilarious. Although it is really, really frustrating when I can, like, I don't know everything, but a lot of the stuff they're claiming is so easy to rebuke, because it's the typical leftist arguments that you would hear, the anti-capitalism that's spewed in every single class. The push for communism and things like that, free stuff. That rhetoric is very, very easy to rebuke. So, it's definitely. I guess I'm just surprised I've kept my mouth shut in there this long, but we'll see how much longer I can do it.
But do you connect with anybody in that class and think, you know, because I'm sure you hear folks, even if they're your enemy, so to speak. You know, when we call people our enemy, we're not plotting to march on them and use violence against them, unlike the other way around. Do you have empathy for those folks that think, you know what, do you feel, you know, if I could say something, perhaps I could, you know, quote unquote, save a few?
Yeah, I guess there's always that chance. But listening to some of the questions that are asked, like the most basic ones, like, I don't know, like, even for the teacher, like, I brought up the 14th Amendment in one of times I was trying to debate him, and he's like, well, the 14th Amendment actually has two parts, and he's like, forgot what they were, and I named them, And I feel bad, and I can see how successful the public education campaign is going with some of these questions that are asked. So I do feel bad for him. But in 3 or 4 months, that's not enough time to challenge their cognitive dissonance. Right. I don't have enough time to say what I need to say. And plus, they probably wouldn't care anyways. So I guess maybe it's possible, but gauging from the people that talk in class, I would rather go with a gray man approach and I guess try to be the man on the inside to write the articles. That's kind of where I sit now.
So you would think that doing that approach, the work that you could produce could do far more to reach a lot more people. Okay,
that's exactly right. Exactly.
So I'm going to read a couple of quotes from some of your articles here, and I would like, after I read the quote, I would like you to imagine that we have a college kid listening, and they're going to hear some of these thoughts. If you could give them just some nuggets to kind of build a shield against the man, so to speak.
Okay.
So the first one is the from your first class, you attribute the teacher saying, "I will assist you in dispelling your preconceived notions and start helping you view the world in a different way." Any flags go off for the kid who hears that?
Well, immediately I thought of social engineering. That was the first thing that came to mind whenever I heard her say that, and that's the first thing that came to mind when you said that again. I guess if I had to say something to the students, I would come at it from, I guess, the small L libertarian, the consistent libertarian standpoint, and say, now that's a personal choice. If they if people want to be gay, if they want to change genders, whatever it may be, I can tolerate that. I'm not going to tell them they can't do it. That's their choice. But what she's trying to do is kind of the same thing as the Supreme Court decision, Obergefell versus Hodges. She's trying to shove this stuff down the throats of these accepting students. It's not
coercive.
Tolerance at that point.
It's coercive. It's coercive acceptance, right?
Yes.
I would personally add, if you hear anyone say anything that has to do with preconceived notions, the person talking to you has preconceived notions. And I guarantee you they are not going to have an open mind when they talk to you, even though they'll want you to, because they want to change your mind. They don't want you to discover. They want you to change. I think that's the key. And actually, it leads right up to this. The restart, which I thought this was bizarre. This kind of scares me. Restart your mind section stated that we may experience, quote unquote, culture shock. It also mentions that the goal is to force us. Interesting. Did they use the word force, or is that your extrapolation?
That was straight from the notes that I
force us to look at the world through new eyes. I mean, even these words are coercive words. So again, you've got a college kid listening. You're not in class. You're on the radio show. A college kid is listening, and they might hear this. What do you tell them to be prepared for that?
I mean, again, social engineering, they don't want you to actually critically think and come up with your own conclusion. They want to shove this stuff down your throat and you just mindlessly accept it. They don't want you to be tolerant. They want you to be accepting. Obviously, challenging it would be someone's decision, but they want you to just accept it with open arms. And as far as the culture shock, which is kind of funny, she used that in the wrong context too. Like, culture shock was like, if I were to drop you, Paul, off, like, I don't know, in South Africa or something, and like they do things completely differently. Like, that's
roll with it.
That's culture shock. Now, like,
roll.
Now, like, when you look at the world and you look at, like, oh, this person changed genders, oh, this person's gay, and like that's not necessarily culture shock. It's really not. I mean, things have, it's kind of gone in that direction for the past 15 or 20 years. People are pretty used to it now. So it's the complete misuse of the term culture shock, which is kind of comical.
So Nick, when you hear that what I just read there, does that sound like a warm, fuzzy, inviting class to you, or do you want to run?
To most people, it would probably sound very nice, but me, I'm not going to want to sit there and listen to that.
Okay. Okay,
people
so
aren't taught to think for
like
themselves.
We are going to break right now. On the other side, we are going to start talking a little bit on the theoretical side of exactly what it is that they're doing in these schools. So we'll be back here on the B block, where Shane will still be with us, as will Nick, and as will I, and Niz will be with us in spirit.
Not innocent people. You don't have to be lowlife your whole life.
Hi everyone, this is Shane, the host of Liberty Under Attack Radio on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. If you follow LUA, you know that we put out a lot of content, the biggest compilation being my Adventures in Illinois Law series. In this series, I witnessed tyranny firsthand, and it was one of the major reasons I jumped off the Minarchist ship and came to true freedom, which is voluntarism. This series is now available in anthology and audiobook format at libertyunderattack.com. Again, that is libertyunderattack.com. Make sure to tune in live every Sunday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on FPRNradio.com.
This is Niz from Disassociation Nation. As many of you know, I'm an avid vapor. And if you're like me, you're tired of being charged ridiculous amounts of cash for a disappointing experience when flavors just don't deliver. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to Vapor Renew, a Flavor West company. If you're into mixing and creating your own custom e-liquids, Flavor West has everything you need to make delicious, satisfying flavors. Doesn't matter if you're a flavor chaser or if you love the look and feel of those big, beautiful, puffy plumes. FlavorWest.com can provide you with everything you need. Let's face it, if you vape, e-liquid is an ongoing expense. And if you're a dripper like me, then you know that blowing through a $30 bottle of juice isn't unheard of. Why pay more than you have to? So for excellent quality juice made right here in the United States, head over to VaporRenew.com, where they have hundreds of flavors pre-mixed and ready to vape at the most reasonable prices you'll find. Use coupon code RENU for an extra 10% off your entire order. Great juice at a great price and 10% off. Support companies that support Liberty by making your next purchase at Vapor Renew. Or for mixing supplies, don't forget FlavorWest.com.
doTERRA essential oils, true gifts of the earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the Family Physician Kit. 10 certified pure therapeutic grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit EssentialNewParadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you. Health depends on you. doTERRA essential oils, true gifts of the earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the Family Physician Kit. 10 certified pure therapeutic grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit EssentialNewParadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you. Health depends on you.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us, or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.
Welcome back, folks. This is Disassociation Nation. I am not Niz. I am just one of the Nizians, Paul, with Nick, the other Nizian. And,
hello.
We're going to call Shane. Shane, you're a Nizian right now. Congratulations. I'll get you a t-shirt later. Congratulations.
Sounds good.
So in the first half, we talked real specific about how you got where you got, what it is that you're doing in college, some of your goals in being in college, both the pragmatic and idealistic, and then a little bit of some of the articles. And I encourage everybody to go to libertyunderattack.com and read the articles. And I love what you do, Shane. Now, I didn't notice, do you do this with all the articles where you have the audio on top?
I forgot to do one of the Adventures in Illinois Higher Education I did on the 16th. I I meant to do a spoken discourse the following day, but I didn't. But yes, every single article I do comes with a spoken discourse. So if people are on their drive to work, anything like that, they can check it out.
I prefer to read it, but I like that option's there. I read faster than I listen. But yeah, I do like that option. So Mr. Producer Man, I'm about ready to play something here. Don't play it yet. Don't jump me, man. Don't even. And we didn't even get to some of your juicy parts like Professor Statist. You guys got to read to find out all about Professor Statist. He's awesome. he's a great guy. Let me find it here. So if, I've taken a video here from the School Sucks Project series that visualizes, and they really do in a great way, John Taylor Gatto's excellent book, Underground History of American Education, which is narrated by the School Sucks Project founder, Brett Vinoy. Is it Vinoy? Is that
right? Brett Vinette.
Vinette, yeah. Mm-hmm. And I love his speaking voice. He's got,
he has a great narration.
He really should. So, Mr. Producer Man, go ahead and play that clip. It's about 3 minutes and 20 seconds long.
The particular utopia American believers chose to bring to the schoolhouse was Prussian. Under no uncertain terms, Fichte told Prussia the party was over. Children would have to be disciplined through a new form of universal conditioning. They could no longer be trusted to their parents. Look what Napoleon had done by banishing sentiment in the interests of nationalism. Through forced schooling, everyone would learn that work makes free, and working for the state, even laying down one's life to its commands, was the greatest freedom of all. Here in the genius of semantic redefinition lay the power to cloud men's minds, a power later packaged and sold by public relations pioneers Edward Bernays and Ivy Lee in the seed time of American forced schooling. Prior to Fichte's challenge, any number of compulsion school proclamations had rolled off printing presses here and there. The problem was, earlier ventures were virtually unenforceable, roundly ignored by those who smelled mischief lurking behind fancy promises of free education. The Prussian mind had a clear idea of what centralized schooling should deliver. 1. Obedient soldiers to the army. 2. Obedient workers for mines, factories, and farms. 3. Well-subordinated civil servants trained in their function. 4. Well-subordinated clerks for industry. 5. Citizens who thought alike on most issues. And 6. National uniformity in thought, word, and deed. The area of individual volition for commoners was severely foreclosed by Prussian psychological training procedures drawn from the experience of animal husbandry and equestrian training, and also taken from past military experience. Much later, in our own time, the techniques of these assorted crafts and sullen arts became discoveries in the pedagogical pseudoscience of psychological behaviorism. 30 years after Prussia made state schooling work, we borrowed the structure, style, and intention of those Germans for our own first compulsion schools. Traditional American school purpose, piety, good manners, basic intellectual tools, self-reliance, etc., was scrapped to make way for something different. Our historical destination of personal independence gave way slowly to Prussian purpose schooling. Not because the American way lost in any competition of ideas, but because for the new commercial and manufacturing hierarchs, such a course made better economic sense.
Oh, my mic was muted. Oh. I started speaking and yeah. So Shane, as you're in the belly of the beast, where I actually think things are ratcheted up, even we are the Prussian school model on steroids at this point. what do you see? It was there, as you were listening to that, and you were describing the goals, the commercial, I don't want to say corporatist. When I say corporatist, I'm a free marketer. When I say corporatist, I always mean it in the sense of the one who relies on government to enable their corporation and protect their corporation. Mm-hmm. What do you hear in the corporatist model that stands out for you as you're just these first few months in education? You're looking at it like, wow, I totally see this now. Because when you were going through lower education, you probably didn't have this perception like you do now.
No, I definitely did not. I will say, though, I mean, as far as it goes, like K through 12, it seems like they're trying to embed these certain tactics and obedience. Raise your hand, follow in line, all that good stuff. The Prussian bell system is also it's a way for the authoritarians to control time, so to speak. It's more subconscious, or like people, you really don't notice it when you're actually in their K through 12. But when you're in a higher level indoctrination, it's definitely ramped up as far as they're very, like I said before, they're a lot more overt with their tactics and their agenda. I definitely seen some of those things. When you look at, and I know a couple of the examples where they wanted to be good workers, they wanted to have people to send to the military, things like that. Obviously, public education is not for teaching, it's to create mindless, obedient tax slaves. But then there's also another avenue that I don't think people really think about. Have you ever seen the military recruiters at like high schools and stuff? It's the same exact model as the Prussians.
I met the military recruiters when I was in high school. Yeah.
So I mean, it's pretty much identical, maybe even a little more ramped up.
Nick, I don't think I've ever asked you this question. How long ago was it when you went to high school?
Let me think here. It would be about 11 years ago I graduated.
You probably don't have a strong memory of what your experience was, what may have stood out for you. I went to high school a lot, let's just say, earlier than you.
Mm-hmm.
I'll just leave it at that. But I remember, without even thinking about it, of course, they still do this, obviously, how we're cordoned off. How we are kept within our age group.
Mm-hmm.
And a lot of times we end up being even sectioned off according to our gender. Males mostly get cordoned off with females. Yeah. And so we end up, and I know that John Taylor Gatto goes into this a lot, so I'm not saying anything of any original thought, but I didn't think about it at the time. I thought it always will be. I didn't realize that this was a new concept, that we took our students and we consolidated them by their age group so that the only one teaching them was somebody way, way high up, the teacher.
Mm-hmm.
Where it used to be, you would go to a one-room classroom, for instance, and different age groups taught one another. So you had the person teaching you was much more equal with you. So there was more of a give and take that was going on. So it really mm-hmm. was teaching, and it was both in a sense helping to teach one another.
Concept hierarchy, so to speak.
Right, and so we've moved into a situation where we're kind of teaching our kids to accept early on the political model.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. The teacher is the politician.
Yeah,
who That's tells true. You what's that?
Another thing they're kind of preparing these mindless, obedient, probably a little socialist for is forced integration and forced integration now, which, I mean, when you look at some of the things that are being pushed, shoved down the throats of everybody, regardless of whether they agree with it or not, they are preparing them for forced integration because the government's the one that does the segregation and the integration. So that's another thing they're kind of preparing the students for.
What do you mean forced integration?
Like when people are put into groups, when they're like, okay, you guys go over there, you guys go over there in school.
But they change them around all the time?
Yeah, and you don't have a choice. Like, go in this group. You don't have a choice. You just have to accept what the authority in the room told you to do.
It's almost like what they're trying to do at some level is
trying to prevent you from building too many strong ties. You know, to build associations, maybe even beyond that. I mean, one of the founding principles of the Constitution, and I know that all of us believe that the Constitution is totally true, totally infallible, and without it, we would all probably die tomorrow, right?
The paper page, yeah.
Absolutely.
If the Constitution were to disappear tomorrow, my head would probably explode. Right? Right, Shane?
I'd say, yeah, there's a high possibility that it could happen.
Very, very scientifically proven. I think like 97% of scientists or something like that or other said that if the Constitution were to disappear, my head would actually explode the next day. But be that as it may, if you're looking at folks that believe that this Constitution is the law of the land, for the sake of argument, one of the underlying principles of the Constitution is the idea of freedom of association. And this, the way that they cordon you off and move you off into the groups that they want you to be, it's almost a subliminal conditioning that you should belong to the groups that authority tells you that you need to belong to. You'll grow up not understanding or appreciating the value of being able to choose who you associate with.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
So
yeah, that is true. Although I really don't think, through high school and even in college, they really don't give two shits about the Constitution anyways. Right. So I really don't think that makes too much of a difference.
They? No, that's true. But it will make a difference to someone that you're talking to. That when I talk to someone where I'm trying to witness liberty, so to speak, I try to find what is their foundation, what is their claim. Now, I understand that the Constitution is not a foundation of truth, but for them it is. Just like Shane, you're a good constitutionalist. You can actually argue from a constitutional perspective, even though you know, because you've read Lysander Spooner, you know that you know it's all a big. I mean, Spooner was really good at using the Constitution to illustrate the absurdity of the Constitution.
Yeah, and so, I think once someone studies the Constitution, I mean, I'm not a constitutional scholar by any means, but I've studied enough and talked to people about it enough to where once you understand the Constitution, you realize that it really is a tyrannical authoritarian document, which a lot of people don't like to hear. But
and while I agree with you, at the very least, it's a wildly inconsistent document that has a lot of giant holes through it, which, you know, unless mm-hmm. we have benevolent rulers, tyrants will do what tyrants will do, which yep. kind of means that we don't have rule of law. My daughter is 10 years old, as I described to you. She is she's going through the public school. What would you advise me? What are the key skills that I should be developing in my daughter? And this isn't just for me, it's for anybody listening.
Mm-hmm.
As some of us, for one reason or another, we're kind of in a position, we don't have a choice. We kind of have to send our kid to public school right now. What would be your advice? What would be the fundamental skills that you would want build up in that kid so that kid has a shield against the tyrannical indoctrination?
Yeah. Well, for I guess more generally, sometimes homeschooling isn't an option for people. But I guess the first recommendation is get your kids out of government schools. If that's not an option, there are a couple things that I think are crucial. Although I think the conditioning over 12 years there's a chance that it could wear it down. It probably will actually, but critical thinking skills, obviously, and another thing which I don't think any teacher or any parent has ever told their kid to do when they send them to public school, but tell them to challenge authority. Don't just accept what they're told because their teacher is 15, 20 years older than them. Challenge authority, and don't just blow with the wind. Don't just do all of those things. But like I said, I do think that over time that conditioning will break down. But I think those are two of the most important things. And the third, I think, is talking to the child when they get home from school and kind of see what they're taught. And then I guess challenge them and teach the teacher child at home. And obviously, I'm not a parent, so this may not actually be correct, but I'm just kind of guessing.
I'll correct you. Go ahead.
Train. I guess not train, but teach your child at home. I think that's those are probably the best things that you can do. Although I still really really recommend people to get their kids at government schools because that conditioning is you condition someone for 12 years. I mean, yeah, it does have an impact on their mind and their critical thinking skills.
I'm not sure that my daughter is going to be going through 12 years for kindergarten through fourth grade has. I mean, all things considered, I watch what my daughter has takes home with her very carefully. Mm-hmm. And our school has not done a lot of the crazy nutty things that I see other schools doing, thank God. Although now in fifth grade, that's when things are starting. And I'm really noticing they're really stepping it up.
And plus with Common Core too. Common Core, yeah, that's dangerous now.
So far,
not that it wasn't before, but yeah, go ahead.
Oh, Common Core is just—it's like a perfection of the Prussian model. My daughter is going through Common Core with math and with, I think, English, but that's it. That's all that they have for Common Core. And math, we went through the process where we learned the principles of Common Core, and I taught my daughter. The principles of Common Core math, learned it, taught it, and I explained to her why it's a load of bunk, but how you want to make sure that you use these core. It's kind of like you going through college right now. You got to learn the system. What's the system of passing the test? But keep an eye on the outside knowing, you know, that's their system, and I got to do it. I got to, you know, to get that grade, but I don't want to accept that as this is the way to think. So far, my daughter has demonstrated a lot of independent thought. When she comes home, she has, and I'm not saying this for the benefit of some people who may be in my situation. I tell you, it's not going to be much longer that she's going to be in. I'm running out of time. And I don't know how I'm going to manage it, but somehow I'm running out of time. But when she comes home, she has during the week, three nights a week, she has independent study that she has to do. And I'm somewhat using, I won't say I know John Taylor Gatto's technique inside and out. I don't at all. But I give her independent study. She loves dogs. So her job is to study dogs. And I'll try to help guide her. And then she has to talk to me about what she's learning with dogs. Mm-hmm. And then she has to teach herself. I have a book of logic for kids. So she's going through the book of logic, and then she has to teach me the book of logic. Now, since I'm a Christian, I'm also the only part of the education, if you will, that I'm making sure that she gets, because as a Christian, I believe that I'm actually mandated by God to make sure that my daughter knows scripture. So This year, she has to learn the Gospels. And I always teach her, you will never become a Christian because I'm a Christian. If you're going to be a Christian, it's going to be because you got there. You have to get there yourself. So far, my daughter has done very well, but like what you said, I am not sure that 12 years of this, unless your child, and I'm going to watch and see how my daughter goes, and I think maybe 1 in 100 would be like this. Unless your child is fiercely independent, has a highly intellectual, developed mind, I don't believe that they're going to be able to withstand the indoctrination. But my daughter notices things like all of a sudden now she's noticing even the thing with the bells. I didn't tell her about the bells. This was last year. She says, you know, Daddy, I think I know why they ring the bells. Seriously.
Well, like, good, oh, yeah. Good for her. Good for her.
Good for you. So, that's, you know, the one advantage that my daughter has in going through public education, and again, this really depends on how well she can handle it as a 10-year-old, is my daughter, when she becomes an adult, and I believe she's, and this isn't any kind of spiritual thing, this is an intellectual looking at how things are unfolding and how I think my daughter acts now, I believe she'll be one of the folks that will have to stand up and fight for liberty, the liberty that my generation played a huge part in squandering and surrendering. It would really help her to know, to understand where the folks came from, how they got where they got.
Yeah, Yeah, that's definitely true. That's definitely true. But I guess there may be another aspect that you need to examine, and that's the sometimes she's. I mean, public schooling is very, very collective. People want to fit in. They want to be cool. They want to be accepted by their friends. At some point, that maybe it's a factor now. I don't know. I don't know. But at some point, children like to fit in with their classmates. So that could
lead. And that is becoming more of a factor. This is why I feel like I'm running out of time.
Okay. Yeah. And I will recommend, we had Kyle Reardon on to discuss homeschooling, and he was actually homeschooled himself. And there are a lot of avenues you can go down. There are a lot of different types of homeschooling you can do. And there are a lot of different curriculums, and you can spend no money on the curriculum. You can print it out all out yourself. But yeah, there are tons of curriculums that you can use. There's tons and tons of options. So there's a market selection in your homeschooling too. So.
Yeah, my biggest concern with homeschooling is, the tried and true socialization. Making sure that my daughter has a fair amount of socialization with other kids.
True. Yeah,
that is one of the reasons why I've held on as long as I've held on, and I've also held on as long as I've held on because so far our school. I mean, not that there's anything good about public education, but. I mean, it's kind of the difference between, getting beat or getting murdered. My school isn't murdering anyone like other schools are. It's just beating them. So, hey, that's cool, you know? Hey, just
lesser of two evils.
What's that?
Lesser of two evils all over again.
yeah, exactly. So Nick, you don't have any kids, right?
No, I don't.
So what advice would you give me for – what I should be telling my 10-year-old daughter in preparing her for the and no pressure, but
for the indoctrination camp.
Left. What's that?
For the indoctrination camp.
Yeah, indoctrination camp. Oh, we have three. Okay, yes. Okay, go ahead.
I think probably the first and foremost thing is I would tell her to question everything that they're told. You know, because there's. Most of the time, some kind of hidden agenda behind it.
And I would do a follow-up to what you were saying, Shane. Question authority. I have taught my daughter, don't even assume that what I tell you is true.
Mm-hmm.
You need to find out for yourself. Because I have my own presuppositions. I have my own worldviews where, I mean, I was a liberal for most of my life. Then I was a neocon. So I'm certainly capable of being wrong.
Everyone's on their own quest for knowledge and truth, and it takes different forms and different pit stops. But nonetheless, I mean, just got to get them to the end point of true freedom. Yeah. They've got to get themselves to it, actually. Let me correct that.
Right. Yeah, they have. That's the key. And that's also the difference between conditioning and learning. Learning is... I would tell your daughter to listen to this show. I can't have her listen to this show quite yet. She has to be at least 13. But I wanted to get back actually real quick here because we're about running out of time before we go into Nick's C&D blocks, and you'll be sticking around for that, right?
Yep. I got nothing else to do, so yeah, I'll be happy to stay.
Awesome. Alrighty. Cool.
So, I would add this to anyone who's listening who may be in a similar situation to me. I do tell my daughter to question authority, but I also tell my daughter to be smart. Pick your battles. When you see things going on, you don't have to stand up and tell your teacher that your teacher's wrong, even if you know your teacher's wrong. Pick your battles. And what I try to tell my daughter actually is, kind of think of yourself as kind of a spy. You're there to observe and figure out what's going on. You need to talk to me afterwards. But if you speak too much, you will be marked.
Yeah.
So I think that that would be an important warning. Or I don't know. I wouldn't word it as a warning because you don't want to scare your kid. But, just say, just be smart, And I try to use examples around the house that my daughter understands. If my daughter is staying up just a little bit late, it's 10, 15 minutes late, Sometimes I just don't want to deal with her whining and complaining when I tell her to go to bed. And if it's not a big deal, sometimes I just wait a little longer and see if she goes to bed by herself. I pick up my battle, so to speak.
Of course.
So I try.
And I wanted to mention there are a couple of links in chat. So actually, there was one good point, and I think this I'm pretty sure I know who this is, but he says homeschoolers have better socialization than public schoolers because they interact with adults rather than children. And there was also a link that he put in there that you may want to take a look at. It's homeschool.com, and it's obviously like focuses on the socialization aspect. So yeah, there are resources for these sorts.
Who shared that?
I would say it was probably Kyle, but I'm not for sure. So
if whoever it was, thank you. I'll check that out. Certainly, it's and you know it's interesting when you're in the position that I'm in. What you have is you have a group of people that tell you, dude, you can't take your daughter out of school. That's nuts. That's terrible. So you're a terrible father. And then you get other people over here, and they're like, you know, dude, you can't keep your kid in the school like that, dude. It's, you got to get her out. It's a tough decision to make. We're just about running out of time here. So as we have started this little tradition, Nick, why don't I hand it over to you? You can play us out and play us in.
Alrighty. Well, like you said, we'll be coming back with the C block. Got some really, really horrible things for the cop block this week. So stick around.
In every age, a technology is created that upends the foundations of society. The wheel, the printing press, the internet. Now, in a world sliding into financial chaos, a new technology is changing the way monetary systems work around the world. It is called Bitcoin. Bitcoin is a new form of money, controlled not by banks, governments, or corporations, but through mutual commerce between free individuals. To learn more, visit weusecoins.com.
doTERRA essential oils, true gifts of the earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the family physician kit. 10 certified pure therapeutic grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit essentialnewparadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you. Health depends on you.
This is Niz from Disassociation Nation. As many of you know, I'm an avid vapor. And if you're like me, you're tired of being charged ridiculous amounts of cash for a disappointing experience when flavors just don't deliver. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to Vapor Renew, a Flavor West company. If you're into mixing and creating your own custom e-liquids, Flavor West has everything you need to make delicious, satisfying flavors. It doesn't matter if you're a flavor chaser or if you love the look and feel of those big, beautiful puffy plumes. FlavorWest.com can provide you with everything you need. Let's face it, if you vape, e-liquid is an ongoing expense. And if you're a dripper like me, then you know that blowing through a $30 bottle of juice isn't unheard of. Why pay more than you have to? So for excellent quality juice made right here in the United States, head over to VaporRenew.com, where they have hundreds of flavors pre-mixed and ready to vape at the most reasonable prices you'll find. Use coupon code RENU for an extra 10% off your entire order. Great juice at a great price and 10% off. Support companies that support liberty by making your next purchase at Vapor Renew. Or for mixing supplies, don't forget FlavorWest.com.
Hi everyone, this is Shane, the host of Liberty Under Attack Radio on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. If you follow LUA, you know that we put out a lot of content, the biggest compilation being my Adventures in Illinois Law series. In this series, I witnessed tyranny firsthand, and it was one of the major reasons I jumped off the Minarchist ship and came to true freedom, which is voluntarism. This series is now available in anthology and audiobook format at libertyunderattack.com. Again, that is libertyunderattack.com. Make sure to tune in live every Sunday at 7 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on FPRNradio.com.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.
Back away from your listening device. Get your hands in the air. You are entering the C block.
C stands for the cock block block. Now get on the ground.
Welcome back to Disassociation Nation, live on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. I'm your host, Nick, and here with special guest Shane, and of course Paul, as always, and Niz is still absent.
Fellow Nizians.
Good evening.
Aw. So, are we ready to see some Blue Lives murder for the cop block block?
Okay, that's fighting's words. I don't know what that means. Okay.
Let's do it.
Alrighty. So, a Florida City, Florida family is devastated after a policeman shot their beloved dog 3 times in the head on Tuesday as the dog ran happily out of the home. On Tuesday morning, the dog owner and rescue volunteer Jillian Pelosius, I believe is how it's pronounced. Anyway, she had been preparing to take her children to school and one of the family's other dogs to the veterinarian. And as she packed up the car and she left the doors of the vehicle open, at the same time, a police officer decided that it's going to be good to go knock on the door. He's on his routine freedom patrol. And he approached the family's home to make sure they knew about the open vehicle. And when the lady's daughter answered the door, the family's 2-year-old pit bull mix named Duchess, she enthusiastically ran to the door, and no one ever thought that, you know, the police officer would be there that early in the morning for no apparent reason because no one had called them. Mr. Producer, clip one, please. There is no sound, so I'm just going to narrate this as best as I can. You can see on their security camera just very clearly the front door as the police officer approaches. And he knocks on the door.
Oh, it's 7 a.m.
Yeah.
Yeah. It's still 7 a.m., so it's pretty early.
Yeah, and the dog comes out looking to greet the officer, not really sure what's going on, and the officer just shoots the dog just because. And the family is obviously distraught about what just happened.
I didn't see it.
The dog's tail was wagging the whole time, even after being shot. So she's not posing a threat to anybody. She's still laying there wagging her tail. It says here in the article that she wagged her tail until the very end. So right there, and you can see in the video very clearly her tail's wagging. She doesn't know why she was shot. She was just coming out to say hello like a lot of dogs do. They jump up on the guest and, you know, they just want some attention.
So he came into the house?
No, the cop just knocked on the door. The dog ran out and he shot the dog.
Yeah.
But I mean, that's protocol. You see a dog, you just shoot it.
Yeah, it seems to be anyway. So my question to you, Shane, is what do you think about situations like this when dealing with the police? I mean, what do you think is the best course of action, not only to get police held accountable, but dealing with the already volatile situation as it is?
Well, I think the first mistake the lady made is opening the door.
Absolutely.
And you never open the door if it's a police officer. I mean, that's, you're giving him permission to enter if you open the door.
Pretty much.
But I mean, as far as holding police accountable, I don't think that's possible. Spooner wrote in his in one of his books, it was No Treason, Constitution of No Authority. He was discussing representatives,
mm-hmm.
and I mean, you just can't hold these people accountable. It's just not possible.
Well, they govern themselves.
Yeah, they are the law.
So that's fair, right?
Absolutely.
Right, Shane. They govern themselves. They
did an investigation and found they did an
investigation
wrong.
And found and you know, technically, you know, I will say though, I'm not defending the cop. I don't know what I'd do if that happened to my dog. I love my dude. But my dude is trained. If I open mm-hmm. that door wide, my dog is not running out that door. And these days, you got to be.
Yeah.
It's better to be pragmatic and keep yourself out of a risky situation as much as possible. Because
why was the cop even walking up to the door? There was no presumption of a crime. I don't even know if he knew whose house he was at. Did he just kind of? Is there any background, any context on that?
According to the article, it was claimed that the officer wanted to make sure the family knew about the car being left open when they were the ones.
So he was there to help.
Yeah, he was there to help.
Was the dog growling or barking or
no? It just ran out happily and.
So you know basic dog training. I would not assume if a dog runs up to me that a dog wants to attack me.
Right.
I mean, dogs. Very rarely will a dog just run up and attack you. It's going to give you all kinds of warning.
Yeah,
now, I don't know. Are cops, especially ones that have to walk beats, are they? I would assume that they would go through some basic training with dogs so that they know how to. I mean, is the standard just see a dog, shoot a dog?
It seems to be so.
I think so. I know that's protocol for any time they raid a house, they always shoot the dog. From all of the videos I've seen of them just. I guess you just have dogs and
you just have to hope that the cop might be a dog lover who understands dogs.
Yeah.
But otherwise, well, that's what's going to happen.
Yeah. I can share. Someone in the chat mentioned Molinar. you're an evil bad person if you refer to anything Molinar said about private security being better than government police. Yeah, I think it's about time to privatize security.
Well, yeah.
I can share a couple stories.
I don't think anybody's advocating for state security on this show. Yeah. Not a one.
I've had some strange dogs just come running up to me, but the first thing is if you act scared, if the dog's already upset, it might attack you, but at the same time, for the most part, like you said, the dog's going to give some kind of warning that it's going to attack you. Now, we have two neighbors just around the corner from us that they have two rather large, rather intimidating-looking pit bulls. And they busted out through their fence. This was probably a good 7 or 8 months ago now. And they were just running around, playing, carrying on. They weren't out looking to hurt nobody or anything crazy. You know, and they come running up to me, and they just wanted somebody just to pet them. And, you know, they ended up going back to their house. You know, I walked them back up there. But, I mean, if I was...
Yeah, I got a pity cane. I got a pity cane, and my dude. I mean, he'll probably growl at you because we've only had him for about a year. He was a rescue dog, and he was used in dog fights, so he's a little rough.
Right.
But I mean, he's great with us, but he's never. I mean, he's not just going to run up but I guarantee you this though, if you walk into the door, now he won't run out the door after you because he knows not to go through that door without mm-hmm. my permission. But if you walk into that door, that dog is going to lunge at you, which is pretty much normal behavior for mm-hmm. most dogs.
Yeah.
That's their job. It's his job.
Protect the house. Absolutely.
Right.
I wasn't sure if you had any other sort of views on that, but.
By you, do you mean the.
Yeah, I meant
Shane or Paul or
our awesome
anybody.
Guest here. Well, anybody.
Mr. Awesome Guest. Hey, Mr. Awesome Guest. Oh, you can't see. Oh, there you go. Yeah, Mr. Awesome Guest.
Yeah.
I don't know. I've just become a little – I mean, I used to watch like every single police brutality video that came – and every single dog murder that I've seen come across my newsfeed. But I'm kind of – I mean, it may sound bad. I'm kind of desensitized to it now. Like it happens every single day so many times.
Yeah, absolutely.
And I know what the problem is. I just – I don't know. It may sound bad, but I mean, when you see so many of one thing,
let me ask you something, Shane.
Mm-hmm.
What do you think? What good do we do? And I'm not saying whether it's good or not. I just want your take. I definitely have my view, but what good do we do in constantly recycling all of the cop abuse videos and stories?
Well, I mean, for folks like me, or I guess your voluntarist anarchist flavors, they're well aware of the government police, but I do think there's I'll say one good thing about these videos coming across fascist book and like and shows like Disassociation Nation having a cop block is for people to like for those who may still be like I don't know bootlickers or anyone like that, it kind of shows them that, you know, they're really not on your side, really not on your mm-hmm. side. So I think that's probably the, I guess, the educational takeaway from that.
Okay.
So.
Yeah, right on. I guess I'll move on to the next video here. This one, basically, there's a handcuffed man being led down the hallway, and for no apparent reason, he seems to have mouthed off to the police officer, which probably wasn't a very smart idea, but the police decide, well, you know what? We're going to whip your ass. So, Mr. Producer, clip two, please. So you can see being led down the hallway. He turns, says something to the officer. Officer immediately choke slams him against the wall, throws him on the ground, and the other officer helps hold him down as they beat him. And it repeats. You can't really see faces too clearly, but you can definitely tell which is the police officer. So it says, Jovan Jimenez, he filed a $20 million lawsuit against San Diego County Sheriff's Office after the officer beat him for saying something rude. And that incident was caught on video, shows him being grabbed.
Is it illegal to say rude things to cops?
Well, apparently it might not be illegal, but it will definitely get your ass kicked.
You don't mouth off to violent psychopaths that put on a badge and a uniform. You don't do that.
Yeah, especially if you're already in handcuffs. Because then you can't even defend yourself.
You would seem to be of the school that every cop is a psychopath, kind of.
Yeah. Well, I mean, you don't go into positions where you can dominate people. If you're someone of like a volunteer's flavor, you go into those positions if you are, I guess, power hungry. If you want to dominate and rule over people, that's the job that you take. I'm with. I think Lou said it. ACAB, all cops are bad. Yeah. That's me.
Yeah, I'm probably not quite in that camp. I mean, the institution of copdom is inherently bad. But I know I myself, when I, I felt like I was representing justice. I felt like I was representing rule of law, and I did. I wasn't a cop, but I did take positions of authority. I did. And I would have, and I wouldn't have done so because I wanted to lord it over people. I thought I had a responsibility, a stewardship. And I do believe that there are cops that do approach it in that manner. I think that we're getting less and less of them. I don't know what the percentages would be. But I know from my perspective, there's a lot of folks out there that we could reach that are cops.
Mm-hmm.
That when we go around and we just say, hey, they're all bootlickers, they're all psychopaths, you know, you've shut down doors, you've cut down opportunities. And I know people that the proverbial I have a cop friend kind of thing. I know these folks, and actually my relations are a little strained because of what I've gone through as I've come to become a voluntarist. I used to be able to celebrate what they did. I can't do that. I just, it's mm-hmm. terrible. But, you know, I know these guys. I won't say I don't have anyone that would be a best friend, but decent friends. And, I mean, I know cops that are totally just what you said. I know there are plenty of those guys that mm-hmm. truly do. They take the badge for just what you said. But I have met more than enough to know that there are folks that are reachable out there that have that badge.
Yeah, and I understand where you're coming from, but there's I guess you could call it two caveats. First off, anything you say can will be used against you in a court of law. It doesn't matter if it's a friend, if you're being pulled over on the side of the road. That's just kind of what I stick to in any situation. The second caveat to that is, but these people that think they're doing the right thing, that think they're, protecting and serving, their job is mainly to pull people over and violate the right to travel. They could see it.
They could, but they're probably not going to see it that way if you walk up to them and say, you're a psychopath. Oh, well, thank you very much. Goodbye.
Well, see, and that's I role play police interrogation, so I don't say anything. I really don't say anything to cops.
Well, I know that you would say that. I'm talking about people that you may know that you may come across outside of their duty when they're a dude that's not on duty. Any interaction that I have with a cop, it's most assuredly guarded, and I don't believe for a second that you're going around calling cops that may come up and talk to you a psychopath. But we're doing it now. What we're doing is we're spreading the message. All cops are bootlicker scum.
Basically. Well, I wasn't saying cops are bootlickers.
I know you didn't say that, scum. But yeah. But this is what these guys are hearing, and the people that I would most want to reach, as many as possible, are the military and the police. We need to get as many of those folks to wake up. The people that I don't have sympathy for. And I don't know who they are. Sometimes you just know the folks that are awake, that understand exactly what they're doing, and they keep doing it. Mm-hmm. I have no sympathy for them. But so many of them, because you were once asleep, Shane. I was once asleep. And I guarantee you, actually Lou was a big factor. We got into a bunch of, I talked to a couple times on the show, even last week. We got into a number of dust-ups over rule of law. But Lou didn't call me a bootlicker scum because I was working on political campaigns. But in fact, I was truly doing the work of the state. But I wasn't evil. I didn't do it so that I could lord it over others, so that I could crush and destroy.
Yeah.
I did it because I thought it was my civic duty and I was making money. And I've actually lost stuff because of my transition over. But if Lou would have come to me and said, you know what, dude, you are just doing the work of the man, you are killing people, or whatever methodology, whatever he could have really justifiably said to me, would have cut me off.
Yeah, and I definitely don't advocate. I don't necessarily debate with people anymore. I just share the information with them and let them teach themselves. But so you tell this guy's been a cop for 10 years. That's been his profession. He can't really. He probably could do some other things, but he has a family to provide for. So you tell him these things.
The cost is rather high. You know what he could do? He could go into private security.
He could, but when people have a stable job like that, even the people that you could reach out to and kind of tell these things to, they aren't just going to up and quit their job. That's probably pretty unlikely.
Not immediately. No, I didn't quit my, I didn't stop taking opportunities to do political consulting right away. Even as I was changing, I held on for a while. Now, what I had to sacrifice, I did have to sacrifice, not as much as what the cop had to sacrifice for. But after a while, it did, and it will get to. It's like me as a Christian, there are certain things that I did in my life that were totally fine. And I stopped doing. I didn't stop doing them because I was like, oh, I got to make sure I don't sin. I don't do this. I don't do that. That's not why I did it. I did it because my lifestyle changed. The way that I viewed the world changed. And so suddenly the things that I used to do, I got to a point where I just couldn't do certain things anymore because it didn't fit my worldview anymore. And I believe that this can and will happen, especially as things start to emerge in the near future, as we begin to see. This is a great time to be alive if you're an ANCAPper, because I think as we begin to see more and more laid bare the cost of the state to your life, it's becoming ever more apparent. And it's even going to start to become apparent to cops and military. My nephew, he served in Afghanistan, and when I see him again, I'm not going to call him a killer. I'm going to try to gently gently suggest to him that there's another way of seeing the world.
Yeah, and I completely agree with you on the military. I know Kyle Molyneux was a veteran. That kind of like that. I mean, a lot of people go into the military thinking that they're fighting for freedom, and then they come out and they realize, wow, I did some terrible shit over there, and it wasn't actually for freedom. So I definitely agree with the military part, and I think Lou is a veteran too. So yeah, with that, I definitely agree. It's just when it comes down to cops, they're the ones that are going to be confiscating the guns. They're the ones that are, I guess, partaking in democide right now. Not all of them, obviously, no generalizations, but I fear every single time I'm pulled over. I've been pulled over twice in the past like 3 months. I fear for my life, even if it's just a basic traffic stop. And you kind of like, so they may see like let's use marijuana as an example. So a lot of cops know that, like, you know, this is wrong. We really shouldn't be tossing this guy in a cage for this. A lot of cops will even admit that to some extent. They won't go as far as Sheriff Richard Mack and say the war on drugs is a farce. But they will say, you know, I kind of disagree with this, but it's my job. I have to enforce the law. Anything that is the law, they have to enforce. So I mean, that's just kind of, I don't know, that's kind of where I'm coming from. And anything, and I mean, they are government police. So I mean, anything government, I'm kind of vehemently opposed to.
Well, I mean, I'm not going to lie to you. When I see a police car anywhere near me, I am immediately checking my stuff out.
Mm-hmm.
I am, you know, I'm a concealed carrier. Immediately, I reach for my wallet. I got my permission slip in my pocket, right?
Yeah, to make sure your freedom permit.
My stuff. Yeah, I got my freedom permit to carry my gun, you know. So I understand that. I'm actually sometime in November, I hope to have someone on here. She's a Christian ANCAPper like me. And I'm actually going to have her on the show to talk about, especially from a Christian perspective, but you don't have to be a Christian to take the approach of the proverbial love your neighbor as yourself. How do we witness the truth of what policing is and witness the truth of what the military is in a way that I think that we can come off sounding kind of like jerks? We sound like extremists. I don't think we're extreme in our views, but we could sound that way. And it's not just cops that we end up cutting ourselves off from. It's a lot of other folks that, you know, they worship the state. I'm not going to walk up to a Mormon friend and I'm not going to say, dude, your God is totally false. You're totally an idiot
mm-hmm.
for following that. I'm going to look for open doors and try to talk to them. And so when she's on, I'll be anxious for you to listen to that show.
Oh yeah, definitely. And one of my co-hosts, Stan, is actually a Christian anarchist, so maybe you'd want to speak with him too. I've had some conversations with him about that. So yeah, I'm very familiar with that. And yeah, I'm looking forward to it. I like tying, I guess, because we've been looking at anarcho-Islam. Anytime you can, religion is an automatic in. Like if someone's listening and you're like, yeah, I'm a Christian anarchist, you're like, huh, I'm a Christian too. Like, I want to hear what this guy has to say because we already have this common, this thing in common. So I think religion is a good thing to use as far as reaching more people. Now, I am an atheist, but I do think that's a good way to bring people into liberty.
Yeah.
It's a good end, so to speak.
Yeah. And for me, I want to, when I have her on the show, I want to. It's not just for the Christian anarchists that I want to have her on the show for, but I want to kind of challenge the Christian anarchists. We have certain beliefs that we have to carry out and be consistent with, which and actually, I mean, it's not like you don't have to believe in God to believe and love your neighbor.
No,
it's a pretty completely. Basic Absolutely. Belief that now I would argue that God gave it to you and you would say that it came through a rational experiential observation of the world. But be that as it may, we've come to that same conclusion. We have that foundation of truth between us.
Yep, exactly.
And that's the perspective that I would talk to. I don't want to get too far afield here. Sorry about that, Nick.
Hey, it's all good. It's stuff that people need to hear and need to think about. So I'm not going to cut you off, you know?
Plain and simple. That.
So
Shane, you totally hijacked this block. That's terrible.
I know. I
you did not love your neighbor in this block.
I apologize.
That's cool. So whenever we come back with the D block, I've got a short video on how to make your own water pump that uses no electricity or no energy whatsoever, only the gravity and a little bit of air pressure, and also Remember the homemade weapons I was talking about before? Going to talk about some don'ts from the Unknown Cat. Got another video for you there. Stick around.
Mr. President, members of Congress, you've been making a lot of noise about taking our guns away. But you might want to review history. 1835, Gonzales, Texas Territory. The authorities wanted to confiscate the big gun that protected that colony. You know what the people said? Come and take it. Because they were willing to fight for their freedom and their guns. So are we.
Come and take it if you want it. Come and take it if you think you can. Come and take it, but I warn you, you'll have to pry it from my cold dead hands. We want the freedom that God gave us, so you best not cross that line. If you want this gun, you gotta come through us and take it.
One shot at a time. Just like Gonzales. We're keeping our guns.
Hello, America. You believe in liberty? Well, fuck you! Why is it that every time I turn on internet radio, I can't seem to find one educated person with libertarian point of views? That's why I choose FPRN Radio! For liberty, goddammit!
doTERRA Essential Oils, True Gifts of the Earth, provide you with the perfect prepper tool, the Family Physician Kit. 10 certified pure, therapeutic-grade oils to provide the care you need for your family's everyday health concerns and potential medical issues you may encounter when sheltering in place or bugging out.
Visit EssentialNewParadigm.info to view the complete product line and ask how you can receive 25% off each and every order.
Don't delay. Your family's health depends on you. Health depends on you.
This is Niz from Disassociation Nation. As many of you know, I'm an avid vapor. And if you're like me, you're tired of being charged ridiculous amounts of cash for a disappointing experience when flavors just don't deliver. I'd like to take a moment to introduce you to Vapor Renew, a Flavor West company. If you're into mixing and creating your own custom e-liquids, Flavor West has everything you need to make delicious, satisfying flavors. Doesn't matter if you're a flavor chaser or if you love the look and feel of those big, beautiful puffy plumes. FlavorWest.com can provide you with everything you need. Let's face it, if you vape, e-liquid is an ongoing expense. And if you're a dripper like me, then you know that blowing through a $30 bottle of juice isn't unheard of. Why pay more than you have to? So for excellent quality juice made right here in the United States, head over to VaporRenew.com, where they have hundreds of flavors pre-mixed and ready to vape at the most reasonable prices you'll find. Use coupon code RENU for an extra 10% off your entire order. Great juice at a great price and 10% off. Support companies that support liberty by making your next purchase at VaporRenew. Or for mixing supplies, don't forget FlavorWest.com.
Thanks for listening to FPRN. Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. If you'd like to start your own show with FPRN, advertise with us or donate to the network or to your favorite shows, check out our website at www.fprnradio.com.
A deliberately defunct dystopian dialectic based on destruction, dysfunction, and disillusion that is deemed to be dignified. But don't be disdained, diffident, or draw dismay as we deliver you another deep walk.
Welcome back to Disassociation Nation, live on the Freedom Phalanx Radio Network. I'm your host, Nick, here with Paul. Niz is absent, and we have a guest, Shane, tonight.
And we are all Nizians. As a matter of fact, I would hope that we could start a Facebook meme, we are all Nizians. I think that it's the best. It's a statement of liberty, man. It's a statement.
Alrighty. Well, let's do it then.
I'm not buying it, man.
Just like the fiends. No, I'm into it.
Yeah, yeah.
Definitely into it.
Oh, can I say something about my buttons?
Sure.
Yeah. Are they bigger buttons?
They're bigger buttons. Yes.
Oh, no, they're bigger buttons.
Now, see, I have the ringtone, but I start with Dan. I have a little bit of Dan on there. So
a little bit of Dan?
Yeah, a little bit of Dan on there. I'll let, you know, I don't know. I am not Facebook friends with him. I need to be Facebook friends with him. So this is freedomfiends.com. You can go and get buttons, and they're like $10 for 10 buttons. And these are my favorite buttons. Ask me about my worms. And if you ask me about my worms, I'll tell you about them. This is the bipcot.org. I am bipcot.org licensed, me personally. But nobody other than my wife wants to take advantage of that license, which I guess is a good thing. And this is my favorite. I don't know about you, Shane and Nick, but this is my favorite. State speech is hate speech.
I would agree with that.
Yeah, I love this one. So there you go. Little Freedom Fiend shout out. I guess we all know. I guess we're seeing worms now. That death clock. You ever hear that commercial?
I did. Yeah. Worms, just, I no, guess. I think we'll say worms, right?
No, we're saying worms now. So there you go. Or something. Yeah. So there you go. I had to do that. Oh, and maybe we should repeat that we are bipcot.org licensed, meaning anybody can use us. The show, that is, not Shane. Nobody can use Shane. Nobody can use Shane.
Well, we're actually covered by a BIPCOT license, too, so.
Oh, are you covered by a BIPCOT? Yeah. All right.
Yeah, we have been for about a month. I'm going to
take it to my house and have you paint it.
The only, only true freedom license.
Yes. You go to BIPCOT.org, and you can find out how you, too, can be licensed by BIPCOT. Only the government need not apply.
Yeah. So, I mentioned the self-generating pump there. If anyone's interested, I'm going to leave a link in the description so that you can review it yourself and maybe understand better how it works, but I'm just going to jump right to it. Mr. Producer, clip one, please.
Hi, folks. Mr. Thessalonian back here again. I want to take you through how to build your own water ram self-pumping system. If you have like a spring flow or some kind of water flow on your property already happening, you can use this system to pump water quite a ways uphill, between 10 and 30 times higher than the actual drop involved into the system from your source. So it's a very effective water system, and it requires zero energy or power to run this other than the water flow itself coming into the system. It's called a water ram or a water hammer system. Up here at the top right now, I just have a 3-inch PVC pipe over our 3-inch reducer or coupler here. And you can see in the background, that's our 3-inch piece of pipe. It's 3 feet long that we're going to use for our pressure chamber at the top. It's just hard to fit it all in one shot to explain it to you here. But I just wanted to show you what it looks like all together, other than the 3-inch piece, which you'll see when I get it out in the field and we install this, which will be the end of the video when we hook this all up and we'll use this to pump water about 150 feet uphill into a system for my garden and my fish tanks for the crawdad and tilapia tanks that I have going here. Let me go from the beginning here on this piece and show you exactly how I put together and the simple pieces that are required here to build one of these water rams. First of all, this is going to be our water input into the system. This is a 1-inch poly pipe hookup threaded into a 1-inch T. You can see here it's just some black iron fittings, all thread fittings here going into our first brass valve here. These are check valves, one-way check valves, or just a flapper valve, which I'll show you here in a moment. I'm going to take this all apart so you can see the pieces individually. That's our secondary check valve here. This is actually the water out, the overflow for the water ram system. This is where the overflow and the pressure will build for a moment. It'll build up into our pressure dome through this valve. Let me go ahead and flip this up for you real quick and just show you. If you look down in there, you can see the brass valve. And if I can flip it around and swing it, you should be able to see that valve swing shut. So there you go. It's just a flapper valve on that side. And that one faces so that when you have it just sitting here, it's going to be open. The other valve inside, which you'll see here in a moment as I open it up for you, this valve is facing the opposite direction, so as it sticks upright, that valve is actually sitting shut against it and will flap open upwards. This one's flapping downwards. What happens here in a water ram is water pressure comes into the pipe. It's going to force this flapper. It's called a flapper valve. It's going to be really quick on its flaps in between as it's working here. Forces that close. There's a pressure that builds. Forces this valve on this to open for a moment and fill this 3-foot chamber full of water and air pressure. It's going to pressurize that system. And the second the pressure is greater on this side of the valve than the water pressure coming in from our input, this valve is going to shut. that's going to force that pressure uphill and out our line for our water ram system. You see here, I have just a quick valve on that, so you'll shut it down to let some of the pressure build. Once you've got some pressure built in there, you can open it up, and it should run just fine permanently 24 hours a day. Very simple pieces, once again, just some black iron, all threads coming out of that valve system, another T here, 1-inch T, going up into a 1-inch to 2-inch coupler for PVC, the 2-inch is going into a 3-inch coupler, and that'll hold onto our 3-inch piece of pipe, and there's our 3-inch cap on top of it, which, like I said, you'll see once it's installed in the creek that we're using this on. All right, folks, so here's all the pieces basically broke down. I left some of them kind of together because it's pretty easy to see what they are. Obviously, this main piece here, this is our water input right there. Once again, you have the 1-inch poly pipe hookup. It's got the little jaws on there to make a seal in the poly pipe. You got a 1-inch T, a small piece of 1-inch all thread almost, got a little bit of steel in the center, and a short 4-inch, 1-inch coupler there. Pretty simple piece. You'll need one 1-inch elbow. You can either get the 1-inch down, that way it'll thread directly in your valve, or you can make your own couplers there. Very simple to do, and that's going to screw on right there to the end of that. Here's one of your valves. Once again, here you can see that valve's closed. If I flip it that way, the valve's open. So it's just a flapper valve that you can get at any hardware store. Very, very simple. This valve's going to sit right here just like that. Right, the next piece here is going to be another one of your valves. You got to make sure this valve's aiming the right direction. That one's going to close coming down. So that's going to sit right there on that piece of thread. Your next piece over here is this 1-inch T. That's going to sit on there just like that. Let me back up a bit here so you can see it building up here. Move that back, so you're going to have another one of the pieces of all thread coming into the top of that T. There's your 1-inch to 2-inch here adapter. That 2-inch adapter slides right inside of this 2-inch to 3-inch adapter right there. That's your pieces going up to your 3-inch tube there above that, and you have your cap, which you see here, on top of that pipe. And then we just have a reducer from 1-inch to 1/2-inch right here that threads into this T. Right there, if I can get it to start with one hand anyways. And then off of the valve here, you just have a 1/2-inch to the 1/2-inch valve, and then a 1/2-inch to 5/8-inch black poly pipe hookup, and that's going to sit there. So there you go, folks, kind of a dry set of the system back together. So you can see all the pieces individually and how quick and easy you can buy all these parts from a hardware store to build your own water ram. So I'm going to go ahead now, put my Teflon tape on all those pieces, and that all I got it apart. We're going to glue our PVC all together here. We're going to go set this up and make a mount for it out there by the spring. Let me show you this thing in action. All right, folks, we're on the water ram project. What you see here is our output hose. That's a 5/8 poly pipe hose. And you see that nice stream of water falling all the way down. Let me zoom out a bit here so you can kind of get a better reference of how high that is. That's about 9 feet or so off the ground. And this is our spring pool right here. This is actually our feed pool where our water is coming from. So we're pumping water at least 9 feet above where we're getting our water from right here, the spring pool. Let me go ahead and show you what we have going on here. There's some of the flow coming out of the spring. There's some coming out of the pipe there. It's a nice little creek coming out of this one. Now, all the pipes are already here. I've got, if I zoom in here, you can see that flat board in the background in the water there. There's another line somewhere in here. I don't know how well you're going to be able to see it underneath that water. This is the original spring pool that the owner had here set up for his ram pump. He bought this property in 1937 or something like that. And so this system's been running ever since then. Now I've done a little work to it to kind of improve it. His ram pump was totally damaged and no longer functioning. And that's why I made my own here, folks, to show you. Once again, you can see this constant flow of water. Let's go ahead and walk down now and see our ram pump in action. First of all, the input to our ram pump pressure line is down here in the bottom of the pool. I had to work it through the dam wall. You can see it coming out right here. This is a 1-inch piece of black poly pipe. The one up here, once again, is 5/8, dropping the water all the way down. That's 24 hours a day, folks, no power. So you can see the feed pipe here drawing water at the bottom of the pool. It runs all the way down right here.
I mean, the reason I show things like this is I want people to be able to become more self-reliant if they choose to do so. A lot of things for them to think about that is going to be very inexpensive for them to do to minimize their dependence on the system. I mean, what do you think about that?
Which one, me or Shane?
Either of you.
Go for it, Paul.
I didn't get to see the video, but in principle, I am... And by the way, the reason I didn't get to see the video is because I have a really, 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 really crappy computer, And I'm afraid that if I put anything other than Skype, my computer will lock up on me in the middle of the show. So I ain't messing with it, man.
Hey, it's all good.
But I'm
darn net neutrality.
I think it's one of the key ways that we are going to see a voluntarist communities emerge is as people use technologies, both old and new technologies, and they find one another, they will begin to build freedom and liberty institutions, voluntarist freedom and liberty institutions, right in the belly of the beast. Right, you know, we'll have what are called distributed freedom and liberty communities, and until more and more people start to realize, you know what, it's a whole heck of a lot cheaper. It's actually more beneficial now. I don't know if we're quite there as far as what people really want, which is security and all that stuff. But I think that we're getting to a point where people will begin to see, if we have more and more freedom and liberty folks depending less and less on state institutions, that we can we'll get more people that will want to leave the state system until the state system is trying to tax people that don't have any way to be taxed. Mm-hmm. And they show up with three or four guys that are left in the police force. And everybody else is like, dude, you got nothing here. Why don't you just go back home? You know?
Right.
So I'm 100% for it. Yeah. It's the key to me.
Yeah. I would have to agree. I think this is a crucial segment. We're going to get more into survivalism and homesteading and what's another one called polycultural farming and stuff like that on Liberty Under Attack Radio. I do think these are those are crucial. You're cutting your ties to the state, and you're definitely reducing your tax burden. You're providing for yourself. So yeah, I think definitely start looking into that, folks. Start looking into it.
Do it or else.
Oh yeah,
we can't. We can't do that.
Yeah.
It was like,
yeah, we're not the state.
Totally changed by us.
Oh yeah.
I always wanted to be maniacal and pick the wrong worldview to be maniacal. That sucks. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah. Yeah. See,
my evil scientist dream is dead. Seriously, that's hardcore.
Alrighty. So, promised you some unknown cat talking about the do's and don'ts. He's going to be going over some ways to not hurt yourself doing the homemade slam fire shotgun.
I just shot myself.
Yeah. Yeah. Bang.
See that video?
Yeah.
Have you guys seen that video?
I don't think I
just uses a word in there that I won't use because I'm
decent. Yeah.
I just shot myself.
Oh, man. Alrighty.
If you haven't seen it, look it up.
Alrighty. Mr. Producer, clip two, please.
Hey, y'all. Welcome to the second installment of the Brojek Project, where we're going to take a really long journey with a few pieces of simple material and see just how many firearms I can make out of it. And somewhere along the way, you will find your gun, which is the Brojek. Now, you remember last week, we took just a minute and turned these into a simple slam fire shotgun. And I talked about the reason for doing that is we're starting at the beginning, and I wanted to cover what it takes to fire a round, and that is a primer strike with a firing pin. And what I said we would be doing today is talking about head spacing. So I built the head space problem into this cap, and we're going to talk about that real quick, and then we're going to fire this thing to see what a head space problem looks like. Now, you saw what I did when I made this cap. I basically, let's have a little side view of this thing, side view of our cap, right? I basically just stuck a bolt through it and left quite a lot of material sticking out and put a nut on the inside of it. So that's what we've got here. The issue with that is that when this firing pin strikes the primer, let's call this our shotgun shell, any shell really, when it strikes that primer, there's nothing behind this shell to back it up. So the least thing that's going to happen is we're going to have some bulging back here. What I actually expect to see is case rupture. So let's fire this thing and find out. Let's cack one off and see what happens.
Well, I wish you could have been here for that. It was hilarious. I actually had to fire this twice because the first results, well, the tubing slid out of my hand. And, well, I assumed that it was because, I don't know, I didn't have a good grip on it or something. But the fact is, it's DOM tubing. It's fitted too well. I could not hold that stuff together. Second time, I had a grip on it. Anyway, we're still going to fire it again after we fix this headspace problem. Let's have a look at that. You can see what happened. The shell itself separated from the brass. And I expect we're going to find this is full of brass and other things. Yeah, there it is. Still smoking. And anyway, that's the result of bad headspacing, is you get a violent reaction. And that's what you want to avoid first and foremost in this activity. Well, there we go. We have rupture and bulging and deformation of the highest order going on here. You can see I had to brute force this thing out with some needle-nose pliers. Not a pretty picture. The primer's actually still stuck on the firing pan. Great illustration of why head spacing is important. You recall when I drilled this hole in the cap, I checked it just like this to make sure that I could see the primer through this hole to assure that I had drilled it properly. And this is a good example of what kind of support the shell needs to be fired. Head spacing is one aspect of it, in that it needs to be properly supported at the rear. You also need good support through the chamber to support your round so it doesn't just come apart like what we just experienced. The goal here is going to be to set a firing pin in the end of this that only slightly protrudes to hit the primer. So let's make one of those real quick and fire this again. Well, there we go. That's a nice sanitary firing pin for a pretty unsanitary gun, the slam fire. Anyway, I like my guns nice and clean, and that's a pretty clean install for a pipe gun, I would say. Got a lock nut on it to, you know, keep it from moving around. And anyhow, let's fire this gun and see what happens. Well, I hate to ruin the fun of guns coming apart while I fire them, but I'm going to add some mass to this larger tube so that it does not open on firing and we can get a look at a properly fired round. Fire in the hole. So let's have a look at what we've got this time. Not bad.
I'll have you cut it there, Mr. P. The rest's not really important. I'll put a link up in the description so people can check it out. I just wanted to sort of put that out there so that people don't think that it doesn't matter how you put the gun together, because it could blow up in your hand otherwise.
Yeah, blowing indeed. Up in your hand is bad, I hear.
And that, yeah, you don't want it to become a grenade in your hand. That wouldn't be cool.
Yeah, it wouldn't be proper gun safety.
Yeah, it's like, yeah. Yeah. Like, don't sweep, don't
blow the gun up in your hand. Saying.
Yeah. Yeah. I enjoyed that. government's trying to take away the Second Amendment rights. So, especially with the 3D printing and also, build your own. They're going to have a hard time with that. It's going to be damn near impossible.
Yeah, that's why gun control is never, ever going to be totally possible.
Never, never.
Well, they're going to try. Have you guys ever heard of, Nick, I've talked about this book on previous episodes, but Shane, I haven't spoken about this book with you on.
Mm-hmm.
Have you ever heard the book The Sovereign Individual?
I have not, no.
No, this is not Sovereign Citizen, nothing whatsoever to do with that. It's interesting that you come from that. That's like the – I look at Sovereign Citizens, they're kind of like the extremists of rule of law kind of guys.
They rely on it for their survival.
Yeah, it's insane. And really, they don't understand its power, so that's why they keep getting – crazy things happen to them, but
locked up in prison, and they never learn from their mistakes. Yeah,
we're in prison. Yeah, I mean sometimes there is a reason to be in prison, but not for what they're doing, because what they're essentially proving is that there is no rule of law. Somebody maybe would light a lamp in their head and said, "It's power, it's power, it's power, it's rule of power, rule of power, rule of power." But the book Sovereign Individual it outlines how. Technologies, and this was written in 96, technologies are emerging, which are enabling folks to basically no longer need these mega systems. Even the balance of power as far as military, from offensive power having the ascendancy, it's now defensive power. The cost of taking land is increasing dramatically. It's good capitalism, you know. If it's too costly to take a land, you're not going to invade a land.
And exactly.
What they describe is, you know, in the latter days of the state. Now they don't go quite, they don't go to ANCAP land, but they do go to, you know, a world where the state, and they're still calling them states, they're city states, which are competing for customers. So what they're saying is, we will provide a service for you. Come with us. We'll provide security, whatever, you know, and they're competing for the best. The bestest and the brightest and the most skilled, and in their scenario there's a vast unwashed people who are left out in what the the new marsh starts to emerge, lawless lands where the forgotten and the useless are left behind. We no longer need thousands and billions of slaves anymore to serve the well-to-do.
Yeah,
but I would recommend you find if you think it's on Amazon, you can find it, called The Sovereign Individual, written by William Rees Mogg, and I think Davidson is the other dude's name. But it was a book. I was a bit of a internet Luddite back in 2001, 2002, and I read that book and I was like, that's it. I'm learning JavaScript. I'm learning HTML. Blah blah, and you know, I've never looked back. I've been publishing on the internet since 2002. Ever since then.
Awesome. Awesome. Good deal. I'll have to check it out.
Cool.
Yeah. It talks about, you know, you need to create you need to be a portable service provider. You need to be able to pack up and go anywhere where you want. Businesses of the future will be more like movie companies. They'll come together for a project and dissolve, come together, dissolve, come together, dissolve. And that'll be the more, I don't know necessarily if I think that that's what's going to happen, but that's in the book. It's really fascinating.
Mm. Mm-hmm.
Interesting stuff. Yeah, so check it out.
Good stuff, man. Good stuff. But it is written by statists, so you know.
Yeah, well, I've, you know.
Get to wear a tinfoil hat while you read.
Yeah,
definitely spit out bone, because there's a lot of bone in there, but there's some good meat.
Well, on that note, why don't you take us out of there, Paul?
That was my Hillary Clinton victory sign. That was. Meditating from the, I don't know if it was appropriate to get that mention in there, you know. I did it! I did it! I killed people and I got away with it! Yay! Yeah.
What difference does it make?
It doesn't. It doesn't. And, you know, Hillary Clinton is, she really does prove that there is no such thing as rule of law. It's totally rule of power. She has the power. I think before she went into that hearing, she was told, Obama said, don't worry. We accept your coronation. The Justice Department said, you got nothing to worry about. We're going to make sure you got nothing to worry about. And then the media elite said, dude, we got you covered on this. And so she went in that knowing it wasn't about truth. She could have sat there with a smile on her face and said, yes, yes, I did kill people with my bare hands. What are you going to do about it?
Nothing. Right. Because nobody will even carry that I said this. They're going to carry this part where I looked at you smugly.
Yeah.
Yep.
America.
Yep, the rulers and the slaves.
Pretty much.
Oh, are we coming to the end there, Mr. Nick? Are you going to play us out?
Yes, sir.
Play us
a sweet. I was going to let you.
Oh, okay.
It's your turn this week.
I want to say, Shane Radliff, thank you very much. I really appreciate you having on the show. We'll definitely have to have you back when Mr. Nizman is on, so maybe you guys can talk a little vaping. And be sure you go to libertyunderattack.com and listen to Shane's show on FPRN Radio Sunday Central Time at 6 p.m. And this next week, they will be debating Taylor Swift or Zendaya, which is the more viable lead singer for your band, if you're going to start one. Right?
Indeed.
All right. We'll see you next week on Disassociation Nation. This is Paul Gordon Collier with Nick Carthanasis. Did I say that right, Nick? Did I get that?
Yes, sir.
Nailed it. Nick, I may or may not be back here next week. If I'm not, I'm sure Nick will carry the show.
Yeah. All right. Thanks for having me on, guys. I appreciate it.
Thanks for listening. Yeah, anytime.
Don't forget to check us out on Facebook and Twitter. I keep my magic in my heart. Keep up your spirit. Keep up your faith.